thoughts with thanksgiving for all you've done. You have our endless thanks, God.
myself, fixated on you, God. To whom, Lord, shall we go? And we have believed and come to know that you are God, and we who with unveiled faces behold you as you are. As I gaze into your blazing eyes, I am changed. As I gaze into your blazing eyes, I am changed. As I gaze into your blazing eyes, I am changed. As I gaze into your blazing eyes, I am changed. To whom, Lord, shall we go? And with one word, I find myself fixated on you, God. To whom, Lord, shall we go?
Believe.
are changed by you.
It's who I am. You're a good, good father. never fails, 'cause it's who you are. Your love never fails me, never fails me, 'cause it's who you are. Your love never fails me, never fails me, 'cause it's who you are, God. Your love never fails me, never fails me, 'cause it's who you are. Take me away with you. Let's be together away with you. Take me away with you. Safe in surrender here with you. Here in the place where we're hid, you wrap your breath around my heart. Like lovers whisper here in the place where we're living, you make me so dependent on all of you, my God. So I don't wanna run without you. Don't wanna be strong on my own. I don't wanna weep without you. Don't wanna be weak on my own. I don't wanna run without you. Don't wanna be strong on my own. I don't wanna weep without you. Don't wanna be weak on my own. Let's be together away with you. Take me away with you. Safe in surrender. Thank you. so my soul moves. The mark of my flesh, the bone of my bone, the love of my life.
There is nothing you can do to make me love you more. There is nothing you can do. There is nothing you can say to make me come so much closer than I am to you right now. As I am consumed. Closer than before. to me, you. Everything you've ever thought that I could be to you, I will be even more. 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 I will be
remember a song that I think Kim Walker was singing when she said, I want to sing to you like you're here in the room. And you know, when we sing to him like he's there, he wants to sing back to us. He wants to pour back into us like he's right here. That's what worship is. We touch his heart and he's touching ours. I just feel like the Father's just looking at us and just saying, you're perfect. Just perfect for me. You're just perfect for me.
Just have this magnificent sense that we've just ascended the holy hill of the Lord in this place tonight. You know, it says that there's a generation who seeks his face. I love what he's singing. You know, when we're seeking his face, he's just releasing songs and words over us, just like, you're perfect to me. And you know, there's a verse that says, how great is the love that God has lavished upon us that we would be called his children. And I just feeling that lavish love, God lavishing his love upon us tonight. And you know that as his love comes and consumes us, it's a consuming love. You know, it transforms us. And so, Father, we just welcome your consuming, transforming love tonight. Father, we thank you, God, for who you are. And God, we thank you that you truly are a good, good Father, and it is who you are, God. And so, Father, we just thank you for everything that you are continuing to do with us and in us and through us, God. And we thank you, God, that you said that you will always complete the great work that you've started in transforming us into the likeness of your Son. In the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Awesome. God's so good. That's so good. Let's thank the worship team even just now. That was so amazing. So, so good. That was so much fun. Well, find someone to love. Happy Father's Day to all the men. If you're next to a guy who's a father, happy Father's Day. And then find a seat. It's awesome.
Well, good evening, Jubilee. Everybody's awfully somber this evening. Well, I'd like to make a special note of any visitors. Welcome. If you're a visitor, please feel very welcome. Jeez, it really is quiet. Is anyone else aware of how quiet it is? I feel like whispering, but I feel like that's probably just making it worse. Whisper gently to draw you in. Guys, if you could, the team could take up the offering while we're doing the announcements, that would be amazing. Offering. Okay, guys, first thing's coming up, we have the Create School. This Wednesday, it is the last. Can I get this turned down a tiny bit? It's just feeding back. It is the last session of the term. So what that means is that if you have not come, then you need to come. Izzy's going to be speaking on Sound of Fire, and that's very, very exciting. Is everybody... Is that all right? Everyone's just walking around? Yeah, so it's the last week of Create Term 3. It is for free, if you're wondering. It will be Ustream, so if you can't make it at 5:30, you can log on live. It'll probably be live, hopefully, at 5:30, if not a few minutes after. And then straight after that, we will have the Harp and Bowl, which is our praise and worship night in the hall. And yes, it's really quiet. Joke. Goodness gracious. Okay, guys, then we have the Create Conference. Let's try not to be too excited. Thank you. Sean Foyt and Stephen Roach are going to be with us, guys. Very, very exciting. They're really great friends of the house. For those of you who don't know, Sean Foyt is a world psalmist. He's written many, many albums and is kind of pioneering a prayer and worship movement in the States and all around the world. He has a ministry called Burn 24/7 and just really has a heart for igniting furnaces of worship. And Stephen Roach is an extremely accomplished musician who has a band called Songs of Water, if you want to check out some of his stuff. Just ridiculous musicianship. So if you're into stuff that's a little bit different, a tiny bit ethnic, please check them out. They're going to be with us. It's going to be a creative conference, hence the name Create. But that does not exclude people who aren't musos or artists or anything. So please don't feel like you can't come if you are not a musician or anything of that sort. It will be expanded to all sorts of creativity. So please come. That'll be from the 15th to the 17th of October, and we are super, super, super excited about that. Then, Simo, would you like to say some testimonies? Or? Yeah, Simo.
What's cracking? Yeah, don't be quiet for me. Yeah, still quiet. There we go. Come on. This is Jubilee. What are you guys? What's happened? It's a long weekend or something. Anyway, we just break this silence in Jesus' name. Come on. Freedom over this people. Come on, yeah, come on. Some people are getting free. Anyway, I'll share some from this morning. What happened? Oh, yeah, we were at an event. Yeah, come on, amen. We were at an event yesterday at Dayspring and went for a lunch break into the shopping center there. And on the way back, we bumped into this lady that's a security guard. And I was like, we're just going for people like all day. So it's, but we were saying to her, I was like, hey, you got a sore back down the bottom. And she's like, yeah, why? And blah, blah, blah. And I tried to get into conversation with her, and she's like, oh, you guys are just going to make fun of me, because there was four of us, and I was like, oh, no, well, just take my hand, and she's like, that's highly inappropriate, and blah, 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 and I'm just like, okay, well, I'm not even going to touch you, I'm going to pray from here, and you're going to get healed, and I just prayed right there in the shopping mall, and just in the name of Jesus, pain be healed, yeah, that too, and then I was like, how's it feel? And she like lunged for me to grab my hand. She goes, that it feels amazing. So it's kind of like, it was inappropriate, but she went for my hand. It was awesome. She got completely healed in the shopping center. Come on, Jubilee Church. That's more like it. Come on. At least people are cheering for Jesus healing people. All right. Offering. Also, during the week, we got up real early to go for a construction site induction over North Sydney. Went to one of those Wilson car parks, you know, the ones where they go the early bird and there's the parking attendant. He like, he gives you the discounts kind of thing. Does everyone know? Come on, everyone say yes. All right, you guys know car parks well. And this guy gets out of this Wilson car, and he's got, you know, guys and girls with the big limp, like one of their legs is a lot shorter than the other. It's like they got the huge limp and the custom made doctor shoes. I was like, dude, what happened? I prayed for his back. His back came good, but his leg was still shorter. So about 10 minutes later, he rocks up in this office. I was looking for chairs. There's no chairs in the whole place. And about 10 minutes later, he rocks up on one of those office chairs, the spinny wheelie chairs, and just sitting there waiting for people to come to the car park. I was like, dude, you're on a chair. Your leg's coming out now. And then I got down on my knees in the car park at like 6:30 in the morning. And it's early in Jesus' name. I put my hands, his feet in my hands. I go, just said in the name of Jesus, leg grow. Leg shot out. He got up and ran around the whole car park. Yeah, come on. I mean, it's like this much shorter. That was like, you're kidding me. And then he gets up, runs around the whole car park. This guy's about 65. And he goes, I haven't run in like 10 years because of his leg. And I'm like, that's awesome. Come on.
Come on. I love that. Offering. That's, I get so excited when I hear these guys' testimonies. They are absolutely wild. And without further ado, I would like to welcome Izzy to preach.
Thank you. Wonderful God. What a wonderful God we have. He is so fun. He's unpredictable, but in like the nicest way. You know, you can get unpredictable, like scary, when volatile, I mean. Some of you may know what I mean. How are you all doing? Are you all good? Yeah. It's all right that you're quiet. Maybe you're just soaking in a different kind of atmosphere. Maybe you're just kind of preserving your energy for when things combust. You know, you got to reserve that kind of combustion energy. And where was I going to go firstly? Sometimes we navigate in the spirit in a different, almost like in a different airwave to where we might be tracking even worship-wise. And God does a number of amazing different things in one worship session. Somebody might be really touched by, you know, just the simplest thing, like just words of a song, or just really be touched by a tune, or whatever it is. I love that in any time of worship, God can actually reach you and touch you, impact you where you are. And so for me tonight, I was really sensing like that, oh, wow. We're not just singing about him. It's like he's so real. We're singing to him like, you know, oh, how wonderful, like the love of a father, you know. And I think, I have to be honest, when I watch other bands from overseas, it's really nice listening to other people's stuff. But I kind of like what we have here. I'm a little possessive of the rawness because, and that's what I loved about Kim Walker. I don't know where she's walking right now, but she's, I'm like, come back, Kim. What I loved about her, and what she's still like that, is that there is a combustive creativity about her that when she begins to speak, you feel like the electricity of God is right there, the nowness of God. And that's what the prophetic realm is, and that's in all of you. But what a gift will do is it actually crackles it and electrifies it so that you can all see it. It's there, but we don't always see it. And it's, you know, like if you don't want to walk into an electric fence, you want the lights on. But I had the coolest dream maybe about 5 years ago that a tsunami wave had come, and the only safe place to go was to the top of the hill where an electricity plant was. Which isn't really logical, is it? Because you would just get electrocuted. Water, electricity, it was really cool. And so I think about the fact that you have two powerful things happening inside of you. You have water inside of you, which is an incredible thing. You can't do without water. You dehydrate. You cannot go too long without water. Your whole body is made up probably 80, 85%, maybe even more, of water, which is incredible. And every time we sing and we speak about the river of God, it's incredible. We also see another aspect of God, and I don't want to talk about the water aspect. I want to talk about the crackling aspect. There is an electric aspect that we've been looking at, how we are light. And I, you know, you just think about that. You're just threatening to be electrocuted at any time of the day. You are an electric plant with water. You're dangerous, basically. I don't know if you realize just how dangerous you are, how lethal you live, how on the edge you already are living. People go, I want to live on the edge. You already are, just the way you're made, just the way you're created. It's unpredictable, your combination. And so I love having chats with C-Phrase, Chris, and we're starting to think that we could incorporate science just a little bit more into the study of the Bible, because I think there are so many cool things about us and about what we're surrounded by that really magnify what God is doing at the moment. So I want to zoom in and continue with what I started off this morning, and that is fathering a generation on fire. And so we said happy birthday, happy Father's Day to Finn. And he had to accompany one of the girls who was going for quite a big audition. And so that's where she was. So that he, it's not that he's upset because he didn't get a Father's Day gift, because he did. He'll be blessed. All right. You really are quiet. Wow. Okay. That's good. That's good. Reserve that energy. Hold it in. All right. So I want to look at what does it mean to burn more? Because I gave that word, I think it was last week, about the four embers and about us leaning into the heat of the flame. And I saw the blue and I did a little study on the flame, and it burns up to 1,400 degrees Celsius. Is that right? At the hottest, like just a flame. So it's like, where is the hottest place? How can I stay there? There's cool parts of the fire where, you know, you can stick your finger on the top of the flame and you don't get burnt, right? But if you try and stick your finger in there and hold it, you're going to discover something will happen to your little finger, all right? It will look like sausage sizzle. So there is a hot part of the flame. And I remember when I was younger, you know, you used to hear people say, you're going to burn for Jesus. You're going to be on fire. I always think, wow, those guys are like salivating and they're spitting all over the place. And they're the on fire people. They look semi-aggressive most of the time. Like they don't get enough sleep or something. And they have way too much coffee, which kind of sounds like us at the moment. Anyway, moving on. But the on fire aspect was obviously what I wasn't. And I remember when I was on fire, I was basically running myself ragged, going to every jolly conference there was around because we were the main musicians for stuff. And good grief. After about 5 years of that, I was a little, what we now know as burnt out. So I thought, okay, you want to be on fire, but you don't want to frazzle. So what's the difference? Because some of us have seen the burned out things, and we hear people talk about being on fire. I don't know about you, but the little breaks go on. We go, not so sure. Am I talking to anybody human in this room? Oh, you are here. Welcome to the evening service. So when we say we're leaning into the flame, what does that mean? Does that mean we're going to come to every prayer meeting, come to every meeting that's happening? That means Jubilee becomes our whole life. What does that actually mean? What are we looking for when we're saying that? It's because we're feeling like the numbers are down at the school. We're trying to pump up things, or we're trying to launch another program. What does it mean to be on fire? Actually, it's really, really simple. We're going to look at some scriptures, and it's always good to go to the source of the fire to figure out what the whole point is. So it didn't start with us. So take all the pressure off yourself. The fire didn't start with you. He didn't need you to be on fire. Really, he didn't. God is a consuming fire. He created you out of overflow, out of pure desire, out of sheer vision and hope that you would love him back. He is self-sustaining. He's like a continuous fire that doesn't need wood or coal or anything. He's self-sustaining, which means he has constant oxygen refueling this incredible fire that never goes out. He is a fire of love that never goes out. It never had a beginning. It never was a little flame. It never was a flicker. It was always bright burning, pure hot, pure love. That's pretty awesome. That kind of freaks our kids out often. They go, but we don't understand. How, does that freak you out still? He has no beginning and he has no end. It's like looking at a flame and thinking there's always been fire. There was no such thing as no fire. It's not like we thought it up. So when we think of being on fire or leaning into fire, it doesn't... Hello. Does that a guitar? It's the subs. Woofers. Subwoofers. I like that word. Let me read to you from Song of Songs, this very cool scripture. Some of you enjoy everything. It's quite endearing. Chapter 8. And it's kind of cruel to go to this part here because there's so much good stuff leading up to this intense love that is happening, this intense love affair between Christ and his church. All right, and so we get to this, it's such intense words, but we don't have time to go through all the themes. I just want to get to the hot part. He goes, under the apple tree I roused you, verse 5. Oh, sorry, let's go to that. Yes, verse 5. Who is this coming up from the desert leaning on her lover? Have a wild guess. Me, you, all right? Gosh. Actually, all right, okay. Under the apple tree I roused you. There your mother conceived you. Because now the Lord's speaking back. There she who was in labor gave you birth. Place me like a seal over your heart, like a seal on your arm. For love is as strong as death. It's jealousy unyielding as the grave. It burns like blazing fire, like a mighty flame. Other versions say, like the very flame of God. It burns. This love that is jealous for you burns like the very flame of God. It's actually, you were his idea, and that's why he feels so strongly about you. When he looks at you, he knows your exact DNA makeup. He knows every lacking vitamin, mineral in your entire body. It says that not a hair falls from your head that he doesn't know that it's gone. How many do we lose a day for crying out loud? It's a hairy planet. Vacuum cleaners, brooms, everywhere. There's hair everywhere. And he knows it all. I'm not talking about the hair on your head that looks lovely when it's washed. No, he's talking about the hair that's gone in the vacuum cleaner. He knows that hair. Have you ever thought about that? That's intense detail. That's almost alarming. It's like 25, 26, 27. He knows it all. And that's just every single human on the planet. Curly head, straight head, weird shapes, everything. He knows it all. That's an extraordinary, intense love. You see, the way he designed you was after his own likeness. He designed you to have a fierce love. We weren't designed to be lukewarm. We weren't designed to be tepid. We weren't designed to be indifferent. You know, I have a thing after a while. I mean, that's why I probably love the drums. And I love the fact that, it's, you know, there's just so much, there's impact and rhythm. Because without rhythm, we don't know passion. Really, without rhythm, we're going to blend into, we're just going to sway. And I don't know about you, but God doesn't just sway and say, oh, I love you. Do, do, bye, bye, I love you, love you. No, if this is going to be a time where God draws us into the heat of the flame, he wants us to know the intensity of what he's done, which is why we sing songs about who is this God who's done everything, he's paid everything, you know, he's carried everything on the cross. Like, I don't want to just sing about it. I want to get into that and go, well, what does that mean for me now? If he's done all that, what kind of love has possessed me? What is the texture of this love? What is it going to do to my body? What is it going to do to my soul? What's it going to burn up? And what is it going to enable me to do? What is it going to prevent me from doing? And so I've looked back and I thought the times where I burnt out was purely because I was under the guise and deception that we had to do things in order to fulfill. And even if it was just pure obedience, just to do stuff. You know, even if you just, we'll just do it because we've been told we should. You know, we'd get calls sometimes and we had like a week to pack and go somewhere. Or Finn would just go off for 3 weeks, you know, and just disappear. I mean, the kids remember that. Like, daddy's gone for like 3 weeks. He's gone because he had to go and do some conference and some other thing. And, you know, you extend yourself to the point where you just think, I have no more to give. Well, let me tell you that that was not what the Father was requiring of us. God always provides the sacrifice for the fire. Worship, it says, is offering your body as a living sacrifice. Why? Is it because he wants all these bodies? No. It's because when you worship and you offer your body as a living sacrifice, he has access to all of you. And he can love on you. So I'm teaching you about worship too. I don't know if you get that part. Worship isn't just you giving to God. Worship is when you experience the merging that's happened to you. So it's like you lean into that flame where you go, oh, I momentarily forgot how lovely you are. So here I am again. I'm just giving you everything because you are the only one who loves me fully and who gets me completely. So here I am. And then you just feel that. That's it. More oxygen comes into your lungs. Fire needs oxygen. What did Paul say to Timothy? Fan into flame. In other words, you know what it means? He was saying, inflame your mind. Put your mind on something fiery. If you're in a fiery theme, don't sing about the waters. Don't take me to the waters of the deep. I don't want to go deep to deep now. I want to go fire to fire. So, you know, there are times where we do. We go through themes, and it's right that way. We do that. Sometimes your body needs iron, and so don't worry about vitamin C for a while or whatever else. Or maybe you need that to absorb iron. Anyway, those of you who know a whole lot, bear with me. Bear with my ignorance. Just move with me, all right? The main thing is, when the body of Christ needs something, sometimes you need an overdose. So we need a dose of the right kind of fire. And for that to happen, we need to understand that he is constantly loving us. In other words, it's not like you coming to him is making him say, oh, because you've been so nice today, Daryl, and I've seen how lovely and how early you get up and pray, I'm now going to, you know, I know the scripture says, I'll reward those who seek me. What he's saying is, I'm going to open myself up to you, but he can't love us any more than what he already has. Not saying, Daryl, I have reserved love that you know nothing about. And so I'm just going to love you more. No, what's happening is that Daryl, by getting up early, by moving time aside and saying, here I am, Lord, he's opening his own body, soul, and spirit to the realms of love that already is. He's totally consumed by the love that God is totally consuming love. You understand? It's not like he can get love more lover. Do you understand? He's not lover lover. He's extreme love. He doesn't have moods where he's like, tonight, not tonight, honey. So I'm just cooling off. It's wrong time. It's like, got a headache. God's not like that. He's constantly, passionately focused. And when you focus on who he is to you, that's why his eyes blaze, because he's trying to get your attention and say, looky here. This is the Son of God whose eyes like blazing fire, whose feet like burnished bronze. You want your feet to burn, you've got to get swallowed up by the eyes first. You've got to see how lovely he sees you. This is what happened to the beloved in the Song of Songs. She said, I am so loved. I'm going to write this. I'm going to tattoo this. In fact, one of our daughters has got this tattooed on her waist. She announced it to us when she arrived and it was too late. It was already there. Put me as a seal across your arm. How can you fault that? I mean, she's put scripture on it. It's like, you can't say you naughty. Well, forget it. That's great. I think I might get another scripture done, you know. It's really cool. So, I mean, it's going to be interesting when you're pregnant. But anyway, the writing is like, whoa. Put me as a seal. Well, it's going to be more visible anyway. That's all I know. I hope she's not watching now. I'm going to get into such trouble when I get home. Now, this is what was consuming the beloved. Put me as a seal. Brand me. Burn me. So we're going to read in Revelation 19 this burning man called Jesus Christ. He's the risen, glorious God that John was getting one vision after another. And I now realize that he had white hair prematurely from all the visions he had. I think all the eyelashes came off his eyes just from all the things that he saw. He just became the wide-eyed, wonder on the Isle of Patmos. I'm just using my creative imagination. So he describes the rider on the white horse. Now listen, I want you to picture the white horse, and anything you put on a white horse is going to be a contrast. Okay? It's really cool. If you want to do something and create an effect, list white background. But look at what's on a white background. I saw heaven standing open in verse 11. No, heaven didn't stand open in verse 11. It's written in verse 11. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. Have you ever tried to stay on a horse with lots of crowns in your head? Anyway, just imagine. It's happening. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He's dressed in a robe dipped in blood. What's happening to the white horse? Lots of crowns, eyes of fire. I want you to picture Jesus. I want you to use your imagination, because he's lighting up, he's inflaming your mind so that you can actually engage with him. People say, what if we're just imagining him? It's what you're supposed to do, which is why we have a Bible, to help us come alive. Because otherwise we'll just be boring, dry, gray Christians, conformed to just doing things like everybody else does. The reason why we go crazy, and if you want to watch some crazy, different kind of worship, watch this morning's Ustream. Let's just do something that's just ourselves. We're so frightened if we're not doing it. Now I remember going to places and they go, are you doing any of the songs from, I love America, but any of the American songs? I'm like, no. Because we write some. Can we play you some of ours? We've got to do songs that everybody knows. I'm like, how did those everybody knows songs get known? Because everybody sings them. What if we just sing the songs that we know? And then are we going to force that on everybody? You see, what's this planet? Somebody decides this is going to be popular, so everybody's going to make it popular. Is that creativity? If we had the right popularity, Jesus should be the most popular person on the planet. He's the only one that should be the most popular, but not a way of doing something. And definitely not a dumbing down of who he is. You know, we want to be awfully polite. I don't know what to do with this Italian blood. It's on fire. I don't know how to dumb down things. I don't know how to be calm. We had a Greek party last night, and we left before all the plates got broken. But there's passion. Yes. I mean, I don't know much about the Greek culture, but at least they've got passion. Yes. You know, I get that. That's right. Break them plates. Like, show me that you care. It's like, I feel really strongly about this. I don't really understand. I don't get it. But I mean, I appreciate the passion. The fact that there's something. It happens the same thing in Jewish weddings. One of the things that gets me about English weddings, no offense to you, Daryl, because your wedding was amazing, and we had a ball, but it's also cordial. We shuffle up to the thing, and everyone's very polite and terrified to make mistakes. What is this? This is the great love affair. This is a picture of Christ and his church, and this Jesus is on a white horse, and he's about to mess the picture because his robe, his outfit, is dipped in blood. I know it's prophetic language, but I just want to show you that he's not neurotic. He's not sterile, Jesus. You're not supposed to have fire coming out of your eyes, but if there's that much fire in you, it will come out. It ought to set your eyes on fire so that people know how much you care. That is what happens. So if that's burning in you, and if you know how loved you are, you will never feel obliged to do something that you don't have the strength to do. And I'm telling you, you won't burn out. You won't burn out. People are afraid. Like, sometimes volunteers are like, oh no, in my last church I was overused. Hello, I've been overused in my church. This church. I've been overused, way overused. It's true. I'm like overdue for long leave. I'm telling you, I just don't think about it anymore. I'm like, yeah, you know, it's coming. Rest will come. I'll be wise. I'm sleeping more. You've got to govern your body. But we can't live worried that somebody's going to take too much fire. Because I'm not burning just for the sake of people. I'm burning because he loves me. And when I stop believing that, I will start to burn for people. And I'm not on this planet just to set myself on fire so that people can watch me burn. I want more than that. I want a generation of people running with fire. I want that Joel army. I want to be in a rank of fire people, because when you're amidst fire, it's hard to burn out unless you separate yourself from the midst of the fire. People talk about, I want to separate myself unto God. And I go, oh, here we go. Here we go. Usually that means I'm never going to watch movies. People go to movies, they go, no, I'm consecrated unto the Lord, God bless. So everyone going to the movies, they go, oh, are we still holy? I'm like, of course you are. Pass the popcorn. You're only holy if you share the popcorn. That's what I measure it. Like, are you going to share those lollies or are you going to hog them to yourself? Is that why you're sitting on the end? I know all the tricks, guys. If you come to the movies with me, you will know that my little Ziploc bags come out and everyone has equal lollies. We've all got little bags. It's just like we're all going to, it's this mum time. It's like nobody goes without lollies, right? I mean, that's holy. So separated unto God, what on earth does that mean? You can't separate yourself unto God. God separated so that he could join you and then join you to one another so that you could all be holy, a holy people. Not a holy individual, not one little burning, floating coal going to the top of the mountain and thinking that by living some kind of aesthetic life, you're going to be more on fire. No, you'll dwindle and you'll go out. Don't do that to yourself. Please don't do that. I tell you what, I've seen my kids be more on fire, not just by being at meetings, but by just being with me, by me interested in their lives. I don't want just Christian kids. I want fulfilled, fiery people that are passionate about anything that they choose to do in life. I'm like, is it a right path that I'm choosing in life? I don't know. Are you passionate about it? Don't take the job if you're going to be mediocre. Don't be mediocre at what you do. If you're going to take that McDonald's job, take it like you love McDonald's burgers. Make those jolly weird things. Hand them out. Do it with passion. How do we lean into the flame? Well, how much are you loved? How much do you believe that he loves you? Because to that degree is the degree you'll burn, no matter where you are. You'll wake up in the morning and it'll be very evident how you get up as to how loved you are. And you can be at peace and then you can be really super fiery. So I have those two extremes. I want to be super at peace. I don't want to be afraid of anything, but I also don't want to become this. You're never going to find me up there going into a cruise mode. I can't cruise. I don't really know what to do because I'm always trying to find the vein of life. I'm trying to see what is he saying right now, because if he's alive, he's speaking. And I want to know what he's saying, and I want the whole body to come alive to know what is he saying, because I'm not just singing to him. I'm singing inside of him, and something of his pulse is coming back to me, and I want to know what that is because he's thinking about you. And he has intense thoughts about you. We think it's like, No, he's intensely possessive over you. There's stuff that he says, don't do that because it's going to destroy you and other people. It's just not good for you. You know, and I think, I wished we had people around our lives just saying to us, don't kill yourself going around the whole world. Don't do that to yourselves. No one did. We didn't have fathers. But then I thought about all the fathers that we did have and the ones who did put things into us. And the one thing that I did have, looking back, is fathers who taught us how to stay in the Word of God, how to love the Word, how to worship, how to have discipline in your life. You know, sometimes discipline gets you out of trouble. It just does, eh? You just think, man, I don't have time for that. I've got a plan for this. Disciplined people usually don't land up blubbing so much. Excess is just out because it's just discipline. And Finn is probably one of the most disciplined people I know until he gets hold of ice cream, but don't tell him I told you. All right? He loves ice cream. Holy ice cream. I always say to him, if I leave half my dessert and I just turn around, it's gone. I have to hide it. So one of the tricks I have with him is that he's just prepared his food and I run out with his food. So on Monday, we're having a day off, I ran down the street to see how far I could get with his toast. And And I don't know what the neighbors are thinking. But I was eventually shouting at him, saying, how badly do you want this? People in the street. So I said to him, show me some passion. Chase me down for the peanut butter toast. And I said, if you don't chase me, I'll eat it. He said, well, if I come chasing after you, oh, no, you'll just stand there and then you'll play tricks on me. You'll stand there, and then you'll charge, right? No, I didn't. I gave it back to him. But anyways, I don't know why I told you that. Passion. Yes. Have fun. Don't be so dry, like toast. Put some peanut butter on it, lots of it. Make it creamy. Have a creamy life, all right? People are so serious. Fire is life. When you lean into the flame, it means, for goodness sake, come alive. Clean out your wardrobe and find some happy thing to wear. No, really, like, I mean, I know, hello, black and white, but anyway, I love black and white. The reason why I love fashion is it's just another distraction from just the norm of life. You've got to get up and you have so many responsibilities, but there's that moment where you think, no, I am like a child. I am going to wear that crazy necklace or be reckless or be fun. And it's the worst thing you can do, right? And then you do 25 loads of washing, you go and deliver things, you pray, you listen to people's problems. I mean, it's like that. But at least you have that part of your life that's alive. That's you. That's you saying, I'm alive. You're not being dictated to by the planet going, I'll just dry up. I'll just work hard. I'm going to lean into that flame. And I hope I'm not sausage sizzle by the end of 2016. Now, you see, when Moses had that call, the Bible says that he looked at the bush and he couldn't figure out why it wasn't burning. It wasn't being consumed. Now, you know, it doesn't take a science degree to understand that that's not normal. People say, no, but it's a particular type of bush, you see, that can actually burn for a long time. Yes, it's got like an oil. It's got a thing. No, don't be silly. Don't be stupid. It was a phenomena. Don't tell me that water can suddenly become grapes. All squished and fermented. Water is water, wine is wine. What happened was a miracle. It just did. A burning bush is a miracle. A burning human being that doesn't burn up and become charred and black is a phenomena, and that's who you are. God didn't just call him out of the bush. He called Moses to become a burning tree, one who would just stand out from the rest and would cause people to draw to him. And he had a leadership call in his life. And let me tell you, every single one of you has got a burning bush voice inside of you. You've got something that will never ever stop, has no beginning, has no end. You didn't come up with the flame. He put it inside of you. John said, I don't even know that I could take the shoes off the guy that's coming after me. He says he will baptize you with Holy Spirit and with what? With fire. This word fire is the same word they use for the tip of a blade. When it says out of his mouth comes a flaming sword, a two-edged sword, what it's saying is it's such intensity that it's like the tip of a blade. It's like the shiny, shimmering tip of a blade. What's that? That's intense love. It's got intention. It's after you. It's why Mary said that when she found out what son she was carrying, it pierced her heart. It actually burnt her up. It's what's consumed her life. Mary was a consumed lover of God. The bride is a consumed company of lovers. The army in Joel's, in the book of Joel that we read this morning, is a consumed army that are powered and generated by fire. There's a fire that goes ahead of them. They can't help it. It's so big that now the flames are flicking out in front. And there's a fire that's behind them. They can't help it. It's so big that it's devastating the enemies behind them. It's not we're going to crush Satan under our feet anymore. That's happened. It's like, get out the way, because this is going to annihilate everything. Most people think Satan's actually under their feet, so they do the little dance, under my feet, like they're squishing cockroaches. It's not that. Most cockroaches are in your brain. You've got to, you don't want to squash your head, but you've got to put the flame on because they don't like fire. Most Inflame your mind and get rid of the rubbish. Inflame your mind of the things of God. You won't tolerate the rubbish. I'm telling you, eyes of blazing fire see the way he sees. Not just you, but other people. So how do we father a generation on fire? We just lean into the love of God and we let him love us. We let him love us secure. We let him love the things in our minds, the pop-ups, the stuff that goes, oh, but shouldn't I, wouldn't I be better if I just changed jobs and if I just was this and if I was just that and if only I had no rubbish, shush. The Zulu people have a wonderful saying. They go, "Tula wena," like shh, hush. Lean on the lover, who is the fiery one, and let him love you into the blue flame, into the depth of the most hottest love you will ever encounter is God's love for you. It's all consuming. It'll deal with stuff. It just does. Just stay in it for a little longer. Don't pull out. Don't go, "It's too much. He loves me too much. I need to do something." Let him love you and everything that comes out of your life. You won't help yourself. You can't help working for him. You can't help it. You'll volunteer for stuff just because you think, "I love people. I want to. I love people. I want to. I desire to." You see, love sets your desire on fire. He is the faithful and true rider. And I want to end off with just maybe just a couple of stories. Sometimes people have said, "Well, how have you stopped from burning out? Anybody interested in that? How have you had one child after the other and just not burnt out?" Well, I just want to help you. I have. Like, I've resigned I don't know how many times. I said, "That's it, I can't do this anymore." And the Lord said, "You can't do what?" And actually, I can't answer him. I realized that what's lacking is just my just being loved. And how many of you know that you can diffuse an argument by just hugging someone or just loving them? You know? You can't reason with tiredness. You can't reason with somebody who's real frazzled, but you can hug them and hold them. And that's what the Father does. He's so good at that. I know some people have said to me, "We just love hugs that we get from Finn. He's such a dad." You know, and if you don't have that, if you don't have the luxury of just having someone that can hug you, I promise you the Father will hug you. The Father can love you. And I've looked back at words that have been spoken, and I realize that those words were words of fathers. I don't think of them as male or female. I don't see the mouths that they come out of. And this morning I alluded to Stacey Campbell. She's been like a father to me in the realm of having courage. When I've thought about stuff that she's gone through, and I've thought, wow, what does she do? And I remember she loves the word of God. I think of Patricia King and her decrees and the things that she did in times of difficulty. Because we look at people that are successful and we think they've always been like that. But they faced their wars, and I want to know, how did you go through that, and how did you come out with fire? How did you come out with Holy Spirit and fire? And there's still fire on them. If you Google the stuff they're doing, their eyes are gleaming with hope for generations. They're prophesying, and they will do so. Long after they've gone, long after we've gone, there'll still be fires burning. A generation of people that actually believe that what God says is true. So I've been fathered by people. So what I do when I'm real super tired is I go back to the things that have been spoken already, not just in the Bible, but things that fathers have said. So, you know, when you go year after year not being able to start things dance-wise, you can start to think, wow, I've had so many of these things prophesied. And I go back to the words, and she said, "You'll have a dance school. You'll have a dance school here." And I thought, that's been in my heart since I was a kid. So when God says something like that, instead of you thinking, "I'm frazzled, I'm too tired," no, what's happening is you need to set your heart on fire in the things that you love to do. Because people that say, "I am frazzled," they just withdraw and they give up everything and they're worse off than before. See, don't ever take the coal out of the flames. Don't take that coal out. People go, "I need time away from church." I don't know. I really miss people. I do. Even people that I don't really get on with. Eventually, I miss them. I think I miss the fact that I don't get irritated. I miss that. Because it's family. Do you know, you're away from family members, you think, "Oh, my gosh, I get a headache." But then you miss them. You think, "My goodness, I miss that headache. I need that back in my life. What is that? What is that? That's called love. And you don't get cured from needing one another. You don't get cured of that. So I always tell people, you know, it doesn't matter if you can't be here, but be somewhere where you can be in the flame, where you can be in the fire, where you're tested, where you have to see, wow, this person really loves, and looks like my love is just little. Looks like when I'm prodded, I just go, that's it. I'm never going to reach out again. His eyes like blazing fire that just looks straight at rejection and goes, I don't care. I don't care how much you hate. I don't care. That looks at depravity and goes, I don't care, Saul, how many people you've killed. And I know your future. I'm going to strike you blind. I'm going to change the way you see people. You'll see people the way I see them. And Paul goes on to become from a murderer to someone who writes love letters in jail. Hello. What happened to the man? He got loved. He set a whole generation on fire. And generations on fire. So how do we recover? And how do we stay burning? Well, we don't just stay loved, but you know something? If you don't challenge yourself, nobody else will. Don't wait for other people to challenge you. Learn to challenge yourself. That's why Paul said to Timothy, Timothy, you fan into flame. Don't wait for me to come. Don't wait for me to come with a, come on, Timmy. Timmy, you can do it, Timmy. Timmy actually learned a lesson. He goes, you know, I've watched you, Paul. You're incredible. You just keep going into, you think you go into jail, and you, there's no other prisoner around you who's going to say, hey, Paul, I've heard about you. You're amazing. You know, you're an amazing example. It's outstanding. Your songs, I love hearing them, especially in the middle of the night when I'm trying to sleep. I just love it. Love, Paul. No, he didn't have that. He was betrayed, and he was, you know, left out for dead. He was hunted down. He didn't know what was safe anymore. He lived, you know, basically, why am I talking about Paul? Because, you know, he's the one of the extreme ones. Think of Jesus. It's not like his own family was saying, go, Jesus, you're the guy. They didn't even believe that he was who he said he was. I mean, that's crazy stuff, right? Where was his dad when he was dying? Only Mary was there. It's not like his dad was there saying, go, son. I don't know where his dad was. I don't know what happened. You know, you've got to think about these guys. So how did they stay? What did they do to themselves? How did they respond? How did they come to worship? Are we waiting for the tide swirl and the pretty music to kind of carry us out? Or do we come so loved that even the first chord is, oh, Jesus. A lot of you are like that. I know that. I know that. I'm stirring you. I want to say to you, you are fire starters, all of you. You not only can fan your own fire into flame, but you can set others on fire. You bring hope to other people. You are the light. You are that flame that people look at and they go, there's something alive inside of you that unsettles me but attracts me all at once. Isn't fire attractive and then unsettling too? Because you go, ooh, pretty. Ooh, I'm not so sure. Ooh, I want to get warm, but I'm also, it's like, is it contained? So, consuming fire. Holy Spirit, we thank you. You're the one who baptizes us with fire. And we thank you that we don't want to preempt what fire looks like. We just know that it consumes us. So, Lord, we just thank you that as we respond to you over these words and over these weeks, that you are doing something magnificent in us and through us. Thank you that as we present ourselves as living sacrifices, that you always fall on sacrifice. Thank you that when you consume us, you don't burn us up, use us up, and leave us black and charred. My God, you actually revive us with your fire. Your flames restore us. You purify us. You refine our ability to detect what is real and what isn't. You're magnificent. You change the way we see pretty much everything just because of your fire. And so thank you for fresh baptisms over this next month, Lord. We just thank you that as people are expectant and as they're writing in journals, as they're waiting in your presence, we thank you for that fanning into flame. We thank you for a stirring within us that we would respond to you, Lord, that we would become that army that gets up in the morning and trains and says, God, I believe that I'm called. I believe that you called me. I believe that you are real. I believe, Lord, and I want to know you more than anything else in the world. I thank you. Thank you. I thank you. Thank you, Lord. We didn't have to wait for anything else to happen. I just wanted to tell you a cool vision I had just before I got here tonight. And I saw Charing Cross as this cross that the Lord had put on a map. And it was like he was, you know when someone puts treasure, and he said, that's where my treasure is. And he drew a cross on this, like, hidden treasure map on Charing Cross. And the cross was the burnt cross of Jesus Christ. He said, I was burnt out for you. Isn't that amazing? That's what Charing Cross means. It's like the charred cross. The fact that he got totally burnt up, totally consumed, totally eaten up by every sin, by everything that could possibly, every disease that could possibly beset us, he became it so that we didn't have to burn out, so that we could be called the ever-burning ones, the shining ones, the ones that appear on the mountaintops like the dawn, that gallop like a cavalry, that come on those white horses with robes dipped in blood, who are completely convinced that the sacrifice that he made covered everything, who are not ashamed, who don't break rank, who are not trying to make their own way in life, who are just possessed with just going in the same direction and being themselves. It's wonderful. What a hope we have. What a glorious hope we have. What a fiery people we are. Thank you, Jesus. And so I want you to know that as you expect him to do more in you, don't ever be disappointed that it doesn't happen the way you think it's going to happen. You know, I've been praying for revival for years and years. And I'm not disappointed because I'm seeing people one after the other being revived. Don't think that revival's got to look like a mass thing all at one time. Because God says don't despise the day of small beginnings. In other words, when you see the ones and ones, that's as important as then the hundreds and hundreds. And we don't know what's all happening outside these walls. We're not aware of every transformation. So as you lean in this month, and you experience something fiery, I want you to share that with somebody else. Give that away. Give that heat away. Give that gift away. Like you're hearing one aspect of the gospel, that people are going around praying for each other. Some of you don't get to do that. Maybe, you know, I see some people drawing. They draw different things for one another, like prophesy over one another, teach, and give away what you have. Even if it's just once a week, just give it. Give away that fire. And you'll see, I promise you, you're going to see that fire intensify. I guarantee you. By the time we get to Create Conference, watch out. We'll be unstoppable. It'll cause trouble again, I'm pretty sure. So thank you, Lord. If you're planning to take time off during Create Conference. We've made it free so that you can come, so that you can be here. And these guys that are coming, I know that Sean Ford carries a fiery anointing of, you know, what he's going to tell us about what he's been involved in the Middle East is it'll fire you up even more. It's wonderful. And Stephen Roach carries probably one of the most pure hearts as a prophet that I've seen as a psalmist. He's just beautiful. And has carried a real rich message for Australia. And he loves this nation. So we're really expectant. So thank you, Lord. So we're going to open up the altar just for people to come. So I don't know, Simon, if you want to come up and do some just whatever, or if you guys are exhausted, I know you've been ministering all weekend, if you want to have a CD on, I'm going to hand over to Daryl, and he'll let us know what we're going to do. Thank you.
Isn't that amazing? Isn't that an awesome word? Just check with the team here. I really feel just on the back of that message, I don't feel like we're going to have a ministry time up here tonight because there was just so much. That message was so empowering
and talking about Timothy and fanning into flame and all of those, yeah. Oh gosh, it was just an amazing message. Like seriously, I'm astounded. You can hear in my voice. And so, yeah, let's just have a CD on if we can. Listen, we're not in a rush. We're not in a rush. You can come, you can go, you can do whatever you want to do. But I just want to bless the ministry team as well. Just they can be released tonight to do whatever they want to do. If you guys want to come and just be, yeah, just come and soak and be. And be in the presence of God. I'm feeling quite drunk standing up here now, actually, after saying that. But listen, thank you so much for being with us. If you didn't get a chance to be at the 11 o'clock service, please have a look on Ustream. Izzy spoke, and both those messages today, Izzy, have been absolutely phenomenal. If you've been around, haven't they? They've just been amazing. And so, yeah, so go on Ustream if you can. Otherwise, go and have a good rest. Get up early tomorrow morning and seek the Lord from 4 until 6, and I'm just joking, from whenever you want to. But bless you, have a wonderful week. Wednesday, the next things that are happening, Wednesday is the last Create School for this term. Please come along to it. It's going to be fantastic. 5:30 in Harpen Bowl, and then otherwise we'll see you next Sunday. Bless you. Bye.